Good afternoon to all. As per the today's class is concerned, we have a very beautiful topic, the medieval society, because it is it defines a totally different characters from the ancient and the modern Indian history. And as per our the resource persons of the today, Dr. Nafkat Shahin, she has completed her master's and doctorate degree from Sambalpur University, and now working as the academic consultant in history in the Odisha State Open University. As for the medieval society is concerned, today's discussion will be more focused on the culture, religion, and the day-to-day life of the medieval peoples. Besides the focus on the political structures of the then society, with a brief and with such brief introduction, I would like to now request Dr. Shaheen to kindly start her lecture. Dr. Shaheen.
Good afternoon. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. Please open your camera.
Okay, hello, good afternoon. Only one student is here, Naresh Kumar Sahu. So can we start the class?
Yes, we can start.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for a very nice introduction, Dr. Shakir Hussain. Okay, so let me start. As the topic is medieval society, I would like to say that one of the historian like Harold H. Mann insists that the heart of India as the topic suggests that first we will know the village community, and before going into the village community, first we give introduction that what is a village. Okay, so according to Harold H. Mann, one of the historian, he insists that the heart of India is in its villages, and argues that if we want to understand the history of the country, we must seek for more in the obscure unprinted records of the village vicissitudes than in the documents concerning conquest, government, princes and their palaces and their inhabitants. To understand the village community in a more better way, it is essential to know what is a village. The reference of existence of village is found in a source of pre-colonial India. The word "deh," that is a one Persian word that is used for village, and we traditionally called village as gaon. That is generally used in literary sources and the folk traditions. Mughal Empire's territorial divisions are well known to us. These divisions were perceived on the basis of river, mountains, deserts, and languages. Aini Akbari also reflects how the Mughal Empire was divided into Subas, Sarkars, and Pargana. The Parganas had a very, very, there are so, in Parganas, we will see there are various number of villages. These numbers are known from the Amber Jaipur documents, particularly from the Arhatas, apart from other sources. Also, 17th century documents from Rajasthan and Haryana show the small number of cultivators in the villages, which reflect the small size of villages in pre-colonial India. Documents from Deccan, South India, etc. also reflect the varying sizes of the villages, from tiny hamlets to proposals to populous settlements. Territorial identity has also been deciphered in the sources like Marware, Parganare, Vigar. These sources also identify the social identities of the inhabitants and the village officials. In Markande Purana, we will see the village is defined as a place surrounded by cultivable lands and where inhabited a number of people available to support the able cultivators in raising crops in those lands. Another historian, he argued that like Irfan Habib, he is saying that the village itself can be defined as a settlement essentially of peasants who gather to live together for better security and for the convenience of exchanging essential goods and services among themselves. Village should be seen as a community, a network of caste division and customary service or barter relationship. Caste was the source of the unalterable division of labor. So there are other historians like B.D. Chattopadhyay. He defined the village saying that a typical village settlement is known to have been composed of three components. Those are the vastu, that is residential land, the kshetra, the cultivable land, the gochara, that is pasture land. So we will come across the words like taksim. Taksim is the summary accounts of the revenue of the pargana documents that is preserved in the state archives of Rajasthan in Bikaner. State that villages of eastern Rajasthan comprised of the, that is basti. Basti, that word also, now we will also using that word basti, that is area under habitation. The second is raha, that is tract. Then magro, rocky lands, pahad, hilly, and nala, nadi, that is stream, river, pond. And jungle is, of course, forest and cultivable land. So, village has been defined in different ways, but concisely it has three components, that is varying size of territory, inhabitants, agriculture as the main occupation. So, the most important component, inhabitants, was found together by the village community. So, here we will study about the village community during the medieval period. So, village community denotes the issue came to the fore as early in the beginning of the 19th century in the British Circle. The Committee of the House of Commons on East India Affairs discussed the issue as early as 1810. British Indian administrators like Charles Metcalfe, James Mill, Elphinstone, and Sir Henry Maine deliberated upon the concept of the village community. So Charles Metcalfe, he is saying that little republics, he is saying village as the little republics, which are almost republican of any foreign relations, which are unchangeable. So James Mill, another person, he is saying that village as corporations. Elphiston argued that during the medieval period, it acted as deterrent against the imposition of the Mohammedan law upon the Indian life. Another person, Sir Henry Maine, described it as an organized self-acting group of families exercising a common proprietorship over a definite tract of land. He argued that in India, in the villages where a particular clan dominated, then rule of the head of the clan prevailed. While where the village consisted of heterogeneous population of different caste and creed, then instead of the dominance of one, the village panchayat acted as dominant body. Thus, he looked at the phenomena of the presence of the village community not universal, but depending on the nature of the constitution of a particular village. There are some regional sources which threw light on the working of the village community. Sources like Arhatas. In Arhatas, we will see that revenue records about the state income and expenditure. And the next is Jamabandi. Jamabandi are the revenue assessment records. then is jama kharcha, that is income and expenditure. Then chitties, chitties are the letters written issued by and to various revenue officials and the state. Then sanads, sanads, sanads is the issued by the diwan, the department kept miscellaneous information belonging to emoluments and privileges. Then dastural amal, dastural amal are the schedule of revenue rates preserved at the state archive of Rajasthan, Bikaner in Rajasthan. Persian throw ample light on the nature of village community during the 17th to 18th centuries. For Punjab, like we have a record from Khalsa Darbar, that is saying that largely contained revenue record of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, and Maharaja Ranjit Singh time period is from 1811 to 1849. And patwari records we will see the village accounts maintained by the village patwari, and village patwari are the village accountants. Then Marathi records preserved in Pune archives, that is Khalzada, a record of land rights or land holding maintained by the village accountants. Then Tel Bandh is the actual received and expenditure of the village revenue, that is throw light on the socio-economic life of the rural Maharashtra during the medieval period. Then village system of Goa can also be studied with the help of Marathi records, and the village communities preserved in archives of Goa. Similarly, state archives of Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu also contain various records regarding village communities. So during the medieval time, there are peasants, village servants and laborers, who are belonging to the part of the village community. However, the term like paikas, those are meaning outside cultivators. The term like Muzarian, that is tenant occupancy cultivators, hardly played any role in the management of the affair of the village community. As highly pointed out by the another historian like Grover, he stated that some shift in their position as the Muzarian appear to have enjoyed transferable rights of mortgage and sale of their holdings. Then we come across the one of the documents, that is Vrindavan documents, that is beginning from the 6th century onward, throw a great deal on the nature of functioning of the village community during the medieval period. And that documents are bilingual, that is bilingual means that is in both the language of Persian and Braj language. They mainly deals with the sale of village lands in its Persian version. Village oligarchs, panch, are ordered to as mukaddam, while the Braj version they are addressed as panch, and they claim to act as in concert sub panchan milikar. This suggests that the panch and mukaddam were used as synonym. Panch formed a collective body known as panchayat. Their traditional number appeared to have 5. Traditional number is 5, but sometimes their number also varies, sometimes less, or sometimes it become high in number. Another historian, Baden Powell, he is saying that Indian village community was an extension of the joint family. Generally, village communities consist from the joint family. But Irfan Habib, another historian, he argues that no two panch appears to be descendant of the same father or grandfather, which is very close to the Chola regulation of Brahmin villages, that no single family should be overrepresented in the Sabha. He rather emphasized that hereditary succession had much to do with one's obtaining the status of panch. Even conversion, it seems, did not deter right of a person to hold the position of a panch. Apart from hereditary succession, other factors like caste, community, money, influence, etc. also played their role in the selection of the panch. Then we will see that the communal land or the communal financial pool belonging to the village community during the medieval period. The historian suggests that the village wasteland, pasture land, and the adjoining jungles all owned by the state. Though village had a right to the usage of pasture land, wood from the jungle, where they paid taxes to the zamindari and mukaddam families. According to him, the common village fund or meeting out official exaction from the village always remained an illegal tax during the Mughal period. While kharch-e-deh is the incidental expenditure of the village, that is, never implied a common village community. Bahadur Shah won in 1710 his farman saying that grass and fodder from the pasture land and jungles as illegal and forbids the mukaddam from other collection. Even in the 19th century, in major portion of North India, the waste and the jungle lands were mostly at the disposal of the zamindar, and the rights of user enjoyed by village community were extremely limited. So it is very interesting to see the expenditure pattern of this common financial pool. The largest amount of thus received was spent to pay off the revenue demand to the state. Remuneration and perquisites of various officials were also paid out of this fund. Expense of the village, that is in Persian word, that is kharch-e-deh, were also met out of this fund. This expenditure were in the form of paying allowances and fees to the patwari, kanungo, and chaudhari. Even the common village loans were paid out of this fund. Panch could also lend money out of the common village pool in the case of the availability of surplus. In production enterprises like procuring seeds, digging up channels, etc., money was also spent by the village community out of the common village pool. All these transactions were conducted through village community, that is panchayat or panch. Common villagers had no control over these activities. The village oligarchs, those who are mukaddams, were never held by Mughal officials in high esteem. So Akbar and his Diwan Todarmal calls them bastard because they do not pay their own share, that is, of the revenue demand of the village, transferring it to the ordinary peasants. So another historian like B.L. Bhadani, study on Western Rajasthan, also suggests the presence of some sort of common pool. From village Sevadi Pargana Jalo records, we get references of work for the village. Remuneration in wheat to the village servants according to number of person. The remuneration paid to the village community for onward payment to the village servants suggests presence of common village fund. It also speaks of collection of dues from the peasant for the same. So in the medieval Deccan, also village headman or village assembly possessed the right to dispose of or were privileged to take possession over the wasteland, land of extinct families. Then we will see the Marathi records mention possession of such lands by the village headman as Mira, while it also speak of disposal of wasteland by them as Miraz as well as Inam. Thus, in medieval Deccan, village headman possessed the right to appropriate waste land. But in such case, he had to pay heavy land tax on it as per miras rates. On account of this, the headman of many villages would desist from taking over waste land, which would then remain unappropriated. Then we will see in Deccan, generally, disposal of waste land appears to have been done by the village assembly, that is Majlasi Samakul Pandahar. The sale of waste land as miras land did not necessarily involve payment of the money to the village assembly. Out of the three documents analyzed by the historian Fukuzawa in 1991, only in one case granted paid rupees 100 to the village assembly. In such case, the grantee happened to be an outsider. This suggests that in case of the transfer or sale of land as miras land within the village, the person did not need to indulge in any case transaction to the village assembly. So, apart from the village assembly, there are present an agent which is known as Kama Vizdar, Inamdar, who Inamdar has held Inam land in the village, three headmen, Patils, seven peasants, one carpenter, one gardener, one blacksmith, one guest, two astrologer, accountant, one assistant headman, one barber, one untouchable, one keeper of the temple, as well as the accountant, which is also their word is like Deshpande of the region, and 13 other persons from the neighboring villages and hamlets. To meet out the common expenses of the village, paying land tax, etc., could sale of land as inam land over which the grantee did not to pay any tax. Instead, the taxes due on that land were to be shared by the village as a whole. So, village lands in South India as well as the member of the Mahasabha referred to sale of number of such deed. One of the inscription from Rajaraja Chola III dated 1241 AD, where members of the Mahasabha of said that eastern hamlets by means of a village sale for 180 Madais. It included wetland, garden, residential area, right of sale, mortgage, inheritance, and donation of the village. These are the presence of right to sale of village land by the village community in South India. Then we come across the village servants and artisans. They also formed an important part in a village community. As we already read that Vrindavan document refer that the village artisan and servants were maintained in not which is not mentioned in this Vrindavan document, and we get also references about the leather workers, those who are holding particular plots, terms and condition of their holdings are did not known to us. So other historian like H. Fukuzawa on 18th century saying that Maharashtra document writes that the servants and artisans were claiming their hereditary land allotment, that is vatan, from the village as a whole. These servants were called Balutadar, and they were getting their share of agriculture produce known as Baluta. Village artisans and servants in Deccan and Gujarat and elsewhere too, whose services like removal of litter, washerman, barber, carpenter, blacksmith, and so on were essential for the functioning of the village as an economic and social unit. They were getting free lands for their maintenance And for a special occasion, the families of village servants received some allowances in cash and kind from the village community. So all type of artisans and servants were having their importance. A leather worker or like tanner was an important and necessary as a priest. Just like priest in the village is important, so leather worker and tanner, he also important. Then like midwife services, which were provided by the low caste women, were essential for every family, low and high. And barber similarly was necessary not only for cutting hair but also for conducting socio religious ceremonies. So in India, even in the 19th century, we will find that the socio-economic ties of village artisan with the zamindars and the cultivating community, those who are continuing from generation to generation. So we will see next that our society encompasses all acts of its populace. Its coverage is large. So another historian like Al-Biruni in his time period is 11th century has depicted that Indian society is very conservative and rigid. And Karl Marx saying that medieval Indian village society as homogeneous, non-stratified, unchanging and stagnant. However, the historical evidences hardly support these assumptions. And opposite to Karl Marx, another historian like Fernand, he is saying that the presence of self-sufficient village in India is an exception. As a rule, the village community was open to the outside world and subject to the market. Karl Marx here saying that he actually arguing that medieval rural society was highly stratified and segmented on the basis of economic status and caste grouping. So there are so many superior caste and rich often enjoyed special status in the hierarchy and were assessed at concessional rates. This existed vibrant trading interaction between the village and the towns. As a result, there occurred significant changes in the pattern and structure of the village society. The overall centralizing tendencies of the Turkish and the Mughal rulers brought significant changes in the existing social structures. These tendencies are extension of great surplus from the villages to the urban elites, recruitment of large-scale standing army and introduction of new technology like Persian wheel, camels, spinning wheel. And we will also see that there are some ecological differences, because there are presence of and with the production, in the method of production, like social structures forms was not possible in the medieval age. There were some regional and local variations along with cultural diversities, like in hilly and forest societies, which were actually very difficult to assess, poses a typical social setup as compared to the plains. Those are influencing one another to the minimal, and interaction and mobility also exist there. So there are some specific features we will see in the rural society, the nature and pattern of the agrarian structure in the medieval period. Like in northern plains, there the soils are very fertile and alluvial, and there we will see the alluvial deposits were there. So automatically their soils are very highly productive and intensive. Automatically the results are intensive cultivation and a highly commercialized agriculture we will found. Thus, Northern Plain represented comparatively developed social formation, and state control was also possibly greater in the plains than in the hilly areas and in the forest area. The region was highly governed by uniform regulations during the medieval periods. And the medieval period, we will found the zamindars which we know in Rajasthan as Bhomiya, then petty government officials, those are Mukaddams and Chaudhary, then rich peasants, local merchants and money lenders. The village also contained sizable population of the ordinary peasants, independent artisans and the village menials. So in the 13th centuries, the Rais, Ranas and Rauts of the pre-Sultanate aristocracy appeared to represent bigger chiefs in the rural hierarchy. But in the late 13th century, we will see the presence of Chaudhary, the courts and the Mukaddams. So Barani, one of the historian in 1358, he comments that they were all Hindus and they ride good horses, wear fine clothes, shoot arrows from Persian bows, fight with each other and go out for hunt, and they chew bitter leaves. Then in the mid 14th century, we will see the emergence of the zamindar class, which for almost 600 years occupied the center place in rural aristocracy. The rural elite, other than their caste or clan base, maintained a strong military force, including the fortresses. The importance of their power can well be judged the way they were referred in the Rajasthani document, like riayatis and assessed at concessional rates in spite of state's unwillingness. We get frequent reference in the Mughal Farman for not converting the riayat peasant holding into the khud kasta, that is self-cultivating holding. They enjoyed superior rights in comparison to common peasants. They were organized mainly on the basis of caste and clan ties. Their territories were often contiguous for the territories of other clan members. So, zamindar rights became saleable in the Mughal period. It led to the caste or clan monopoly become vulnerable. So at this point, it is very interesting to know that the assimilation of pre-Sultanate aristocracy and the growth and emergence of the zamindar class in the rural society. Historian like Irfan Habib finds the origin and growth of this class of the zamindars in the emergence of the Rajput, a caste or class, a phenomenon preceding the beginning of the medieval period. So the Rajput generally trace their origin from the Rajputras. Irfan Habib, he again saying that Rajputras are mentioned in the Baksali manuscript, that is a mathematical work written on Burk Bark, so called because it was found in the 1881 near the village Baksali. There is also reference in Chachnama in 19th century of a cavalry of 5,000, some of kings. Irfan Habib comments, he analyzed that one can conjecture that a number of the class of allied cavalry troopers begin to coalesce into a large caste. Then we will see that Lekha Paddhati is a collection of document found from Gujarat mentioned that Rajputra could apply to a Ranaka, and it illustrated them acquiring key position in the power structure. So, in the Mughal period, Zamindar often belonged to dominant caste. The nature and pattern of their rights and perquisites varied as per the rights of a particular clan or caste. Mughal Zamindars possessed forts and maintained armed retainers. Abul Fazl records that the total strength of the Zamindar was 384558 cavalry and 4270577 infantry, 1863 elephants. So 4260 cannon pieces and 4500 boats. Similarly, in Rajasthan, the Bhomiyas maintained ghadis, that is forts. And we also see the chitthis in Rajasthan that are full of complaints against the oppressive and terror of the Bhomiyas. They even did not spare the local traders and frequently looted and harassed them. At times, it was very difficult for the state to collect revenue from such zamindars and Bhomiyas. Many a time, the Riyat also supported the zamindars on account of the caste or clan ties. They were able to enlist the support of peasant at time of crisis or conflict against the state or Mansabdar. So Irfan Habib during this time comment that Aurangzeb official historians employ the word like zamindarana in the sense of disloyal or treacherous conduct. Here, the attitude reflects the suspicion of the Mughal ruling class towards chiefs and lesser zamindars who, because of their armed power, always posed a challenge to it. There was also here possibly a cultural divide as well, a contempt of the urban-based elite for the rural magnates. Here, Irfan Habib comment that zamindari status there usually followed a process of Rajputization, that is, modern condition not interfere, a number of Jat zamindar would have created the Rajput caste. Then we found the spread of Ijra. Ijra is the revenue farming that is prevalent in Rajasthan during the late 17th century, which is led to the rise of new class of territorial magnates, the thikanedars. Then we've seen in the medieval society what are the conditions of the peasants. So peasants were peasants, if we will see their condition, they were not in a homogeneous group. The rich peasants often formed part of the rural elites. They were commonly termed as Khud Kasta or Kalantaran or Paltis. Like resident cultivators in Maharashtra, they were known as Thani, while in eastern Rajasthan, they were called Gharu Kala, and in western Rajasthan, the privileged class of the Mukti. They possessed their own granary, well, house, and plows. They used to get their land cultivated with the help of hired labor in addition to their family labor. Then, next to the peasant are the ordinary peasants. Ordinary peasants are the Rayat, Reza Raya, or Karsas in the rural hierarchy. they formed majority in the village. Their numbers are very high, so they formed the majority in the village. The Pai or Pahi caste in western Rajasthan, they were known as Osari outside cultivators, and the Muzarian sharecroppers were next in the hierarchy. There appears to have existed considerable economic differentiations, and this economic differentiation, according to Irfan Habib, got reinforced and consolidated by the caste system. Then we will see the Pahis. Pahis are their counterpart in the Deccan was Upari. They were not the resident cultivator, but they were peasants cultivating the lands in villages other than their own. Usually they were the migrants from the neighboring villages or pargana to the villages either deserted or where cultivable land was available. So they were generally assessed at concessional rates. The village patel were known as village headmen, normally played an important role in bringing this new Assamese or Pahis. State encouraged the Pahis there are also we will found a evidence to suggest that there was a tendency to convert the Pahi land into Khod Kasta holdings. However, they did not possess the right to sell their holdings or assign them on Ijra. Ijra is revenue farming. The differential rate of revenue was assessed on the basis of caste. The Rayas or Karsas were assessed at the highest rate. Thus, the burden of taxation was probably highest upon in medieval period. In a late 17th century, the Sural Amal of Pargana Jhak in eastern Rajasthan clearly mentioned that the Rayas had to pay at the rate of 50% of the produce, while Patels, Patwaris, Mahajans and Pahis paid 40%. The Rajputs were to pay 25 to 33%, while the Chaudharis and Kanungo were charged even less. Less means only 25%. Khud Kasta people, so they were exempted. They were not to pay taxes from like house tax and marriage tax. So they were not, but they were not exempted from paying gaon kharch. Gaon kharch means village expenses. So these small peasants were constantly under debt for meeting the expenses for purchasing seed, plough, oxen, etc. Mughal state acknowledged that Aurangzeb in one of his farman that the peasants lived in debt for subsistence. The Pahis had the permission to build their own establishment means Chhappar Bandi, and they possessed their own plough. These Pahis were instrumental in the growth and expansion of cultivation. Since the land was available in abundance, these Pahis could assume the proprietorship, that is Malik. Thus the Khud caste, that is self-cultivated, and Pahi caste were in fact not mutually exclusive categories. Instead, the division between the two was not very rigid. However, during the 19th century, as a result of introduction of proprietorship laws, the position of the Pahis got reduced to tenant will. Then the Muzarian. The Muzarians were the tenants who used to cultivate the land of superior caste or landholders. They also served as state-sponsored tenants. In the case, they were asked to cultivate surplus lands or abandoned lands. In the village, they were also sharecroppers. They were referred to in Rajasthani document as Sanjhedars. Rajasthani documents show that the sharecroppers were assessed at differential rates. One who belonged to superior caste was normally assessed at concessional rate, while the peasants had to pay the land tax at normal rates. So in Western Rajasthan, we will come across the various category, that is peasant called Basi, BASI, that is Basi colonel. Another historians like Colonel James Todd, he mentioned that they were neither slaves nor free. So on the basis of Jalor Vigas identifies this Basi peasants as those peasants who would have wholesale with their master to new settlements. They were not necessarily cultivating the land of the village where they would reside. Instead, they could cultivate more than one village's land. While there was presence of exclusive Basi villages, there were certain villages which were both Basi and Rayati. So the caste composition of the Basi and Rayati villages show that no Basi or Rayati cultivators belong to the manual caste. Gujars were entered as Basi but not as Rayati in Western Rajasthan. So Rajput formed the highest group among the Basi cultivators. This shows that probably all major agricultural castes were part of Basi cultivating caste, while manual caste remained outside the fold. So, generally speaking, peasants were hard pressed. Even though they were proprietors, their position was almost like semi-serf, for they were not allowed to abandon the land. In case of their flight, officials were asked to bring them back by the use of force. Peasants often took money from money lenders to pay land revenue and for seeds, oxen, etc., as well as for maintaining their life on account of high interest rates. This loans amounted to as high as 5 times the principal amount in some cases. So the cultivation of superior landholders largely depended upon agriculture laborers, that is mazoors, halis. This landless laborers, or we will also say the manual caste, formed about 1/6 to the 1/5 of the village population. This manual caste were prohibited to take on agriculture, thus provided a vast battery of reserve labor force. The tanners, scavengers, dhanuks, etc., were not pursuing their professions, worked as agricultural laborers. They were compelled to perform begar, that is forced labor, by the superior caste. The agricultural labors or manuals were so crucial in the rural society. So Irfan Habib, one of the historians, he's saying that that they formed pillar of Indian peasant agriculture. He also saying that the pauperized peasants often turned into wage laborers, but such peasant laborers were limited. And another important aspect in medieval rural society was complete absence of agricultural slaves. Though the slavery was very rampant in the urban areas. So what we will see that the medieval rural society was highly stratified, and this stratification was the result of many factors like resource base, that is availability of seeds, oxen, agricultural implements, Persian wheel, well or irrigation. And also caste also intensified the stratification. The higher castes were assessed at lower rates, and lower castes had to pay revenue at much higher rate. The nature and pattern of crops produced further intensified the gulf those who could produce cash crops could be better placed than those cultivating food crops. So the differentiation further depends on the basis of who reaped one crop a year and those growing more than 4 to 5 crops. Referring to the Khasra Jamabandi document in 1776 AD of Pargana, that is in eastern Rajasthan, that 36 cultivators, 16 cultivated one crop only, the next 11 cultivated, that is 2 to 4 crops, while 9 cultivated more than 5 crops. Out of this 9 cultivators, 2 were patels, that is village headmen. The Khasra documents in 1791 AD of Kasba Sabdaspur, Pargana, Sawai Jaipur also show the same trend where 6 to 9 crops were produced by 6 patels. So our historian Irfan Habib, he now justifying that the peasants cultivating more crops usually cultivated larger areas of land. The peasant cultivating more crops largely cultivated larger areas of land. He's saying that the individual property gave rise to condition of social hierarchy in the medieval period. He also adds that the retrogressive nature of the land tax was also likely to assist the process of differentiation. While commercialization on the one hand resulted in intensification of social stratification, on the other hand, it led to increase in cash flow and thus added prosperity. According to another historian, Satish Chandra, he's saying that monetization, caste nexus, and natural calamities accentuated the process of social segmentation. But Chetan Singh thinks that it definitely benefited the prosperity of the small peasant in the Punjab region, because he thinks that social stratification was greater in the more developed region and such changes was more noticeable at the level of intermediary zamindar. As a result, commercialization of agriculture at Bayana, chief center of indigo production, many rich merchants involved themselves in the production. Thus, so they are turned into a farmer. Then we will see the tribes. The tribes were highly semi-nomadic in nature and of pastoral variety. During our period, the nomadic character of the tribes was limited. The tribal of Western Rajasthan as cultivators, while mayors were entered as revenue payers and agriculturists. In the Punjab region, tribes like the Bhattis and the Jats were more or less settled in a particular region. Pastoral or tribal societies largely recognized the collective claim over land and its use. Therefore, they were comparatively more egalitarian. But as they adopt settled agriculture, hierarchy crept in. So, Yusufzai clan of the Afghans in Swat Valley became land-owing peasants, but their counterparts, fakir, who were shepherds and laborers, were to stay outside the tribe and were not allowed to be part of the tribal assembly. So other than members were not to be taxed, but fakirs were to pay taxes. But such stratification was otherwise not evident among other Afghan tribes. Then we will see that the dominant form of sustenance among the tribal communities was pastoralism. Nonetheless, tribes' response to situations was different as per their ecological surroundings and situations. They were subtle movement. Their subtle movement of the tribal towards sedentarization This process of sedentarization of the pastoralists continued unabated throughout the medieval period. Chetan Singh believed that the commercialization of agriculture and the increase in the extent of cultivation were two crucial factors behind this transformation. The assimilation of tribes into rural social categories could be discerned by different terminology used for them by modern historians and contemporary chronicles. They called them zamindars, peasants, chiefs, etc. So, in the case of Jat tribe, this process is clearly visible. As they moved northward, they abandoned pastoralism and opted sedentary agriculture. Here mentioned that cattle herders, similarly in the Chachnama in 9th century and Persian translation, they were referred to as pastoralists, soldiers and the boatmen. So Alberuni in 1030 AD record them as cattle owners and low Sudra people. And Irfan Habib saying that their northward migration in southern Punjab from Sindh towards Multan occurred sometime around in 11th century. Babar mentioned that Jats and Gujars residing in the hill of Bheda, but in 16th century they emerged as settled agriculturists and prominent zamindars in the region. Chetan Singh in 1985, he argued that Persian wheel was not fundamental necessity to the extension of cultivation, and Persian wheel was not entirely coextensive with the area which had a predominantly Jat peasantry. So, further argue that Jat's transformation into sedentarization was influenced by the areas in which they resided or chose to migrate. Climate and topography facilitated, even encouraged, such a process of sedentarization. He arguing that the same tribe existing in two distinct areas not necessarily reflecting the same socio-economic similarity. However, even once they sedentarized, their preference to keep animal husbandry continued to remain an important socio-economic feature of their social system. During Humayun period in Pargana, Afghans were recorded as zamindars. Later in Akbar period, they got replaced by the Jat zamindars. Jats thus moved up in the existing social hierarchy. Chetan accepts that this change was prompted more as a result of the socio-economic development rather than political interference. However, we do get instance of creation of zamindaris as a result of state action. Another section living in inhospitable terrain continued with pastoralism. So, the process of transition of the Jats from pastoral to settled agriculturist was by no means complete in the 17th century. We will see the another tribes like Ghakars and Khokars. They were experienced the same process of assimilation in Punjab. This encroachment often met with resistance. By 19th century, the Khokars' presence among Jats and Rajput point to their assimilation. Babar mentions Jat villages with Ghakar chiefs. Ghakar chiefs were incorporated into the mainstream by the Mughals, who granted them Mansab. Gujars were also assimilated by the same process. Akbar established a separate town, Gujarat, for them. Similar was the case of the Bhattis bordering Rajasthan. They continued as pastoralists. Even in the 19th century, they were mentioned as rebel of Lakhi jungle by Jahangir. They were the noted zamindars in the Bet, Jalandhar, Dob and Bari Dob regions of the Punjab. The tribal societies that got assimilated into agricultural society appears to have subsumed their tribal identity with some sort of caste in the existing rural caste-based multi-layered hierarchical society. The social position of these tribals so assimilated into the rural society was often fragile. Though in certain cases like Gurkhas in the northwest who dominated over the sedentary agriculturists, in general there appears to be subordination of the tribals to the settled agriculturists, particularly as seasonal laborers or else employed as soldiers. So Manuki, another historian, he's saying that employment of bhattis of Lakhi jungle in the military service of the Fauzdar, with increasing commercialization, there was more demand for labor force. This requirement was fulfilled to a certain extent, at least in the peripheral areas surrounded by hills and mountains by the tribal population. Then we will see that tribals were generally represented as notorious highway robbers involved in loot and plunder by the contemporary historians. Bhattis were particularly mentioned by the contemporary historian Bal Krishna Brahman, who present in the early year of Aurangzeb, and traveler Niccolo Manucci as plunderers and raiders in the region of Lakhi jungle. So around Attock region, Khattars were involved in robbery and sedition. Plunder was their means of livelihood. The difficult terrain provided them easy route to escape. According to Chetan Singh, the chief reason behind this constant raids and plunder were their non-pastoral requirements. The process of assimilation to a certain extent depends upon the pace of the economic growth. The greater the economic growth, faster would be assimilation. During the medieval period, since state's interest was in expanding cultivation to maximize the revenue returns, it often resulted in clashes between the two. The caste often tried to expand at the cost of the forest or tribal regions. Likewise, the tribals or pastoralists were in constant requirement for agricultural and craft products, particularly cloth. Thus, there had to be a constant link between the pastoralist and the sedentary agriculturist. This reliance and exchange between the two will continue unbroken. In certain strategically located areas, this interaction resulted in the involvement of the tribals in trade, and they functioned as a crucial link in the trading network. Lohani Afghans were the known tribal traders in the Ghazni region. Their migration to India was a result of their movement in the territory to procure goods from India for trade. They served as the mediators and crucial links in the overseas trade. Alexander Burns argues that their seasonal migration suggests links either coincidentally or intentionally with the trading communities. Some smaller tribal groups must be operating in this trading network. Though at comparatively modest level, what Grover refers here, the Gujars of Punjab, who used to exchange merchandise in small quantity during their seasonal movement. The Khatiyas of Punjab were the suppliers of butter to the town. Supply of refined butter from Sarkar Hisar Firuza to the imperial kitchen must have been supplied by the pastoral communities of the region. So Bhadani, in 1999, he calculated the total amount of ghee extracted in the form of tax amounted to 21,775 sets in Pargana, Falodi in Western Rajasthan for the year 1667-68. He mentioned that a Kanungo Bhai records that total amount of ghee transported for sale in 1662 amounted to approximately 650 mounds from Khalisa village. Then, timber was a regular item of supply via river Rhine route from the hills. Lahore boat building industry survived on timber obtained from the mountain regions of Punjab. Muhammad Kazim in 1668 mentioned that the fine alloy wood was obtained in huge quantity from the mountains of Assam from the Nang Naga tribe inhabiting the mountains. Similarly, musk that was largely produced in Kashmir and Assam, Tavernier reports that he bought musk worth 26,000 rupees at Patna. This suggests hectic exchange of forest or hill produce during the medieval period. So Mirza Haider, in his Tarikh-e-Rashdi, informed us about the involvement of Tibetan nobles in trade with India. They used to carry cheap loads at time as much as 10,000 and used to return back with rice, clothes, sweets, grains, etc. Interestingly, this transaction used to take place in the hills itself. So then we will see the caste. That is, caste was at the core of the rural social structure. No aspect of rural society could well be explained without understanding caste operations. Irfan Habib, the historian, he is saying that the caste system remained an important pillar of the system of class exploitation in medieval India. Babur found it somewhat astonishing that in our country, the people who are nobles of the steppes are distinguished by name of different tribes. But here in Hindustan, people settled in the country and villages are distinguished by the names of tribes. Generally speaking, Indian villages consisted of one caste only. Though instances of presence of more than one caste in a single village are not absent at the same time. So, peasants brought from outside by the local potentates, these settlers were from various caste groups. And caste was the major component in establishing hierarchy in the rural society, particularly in the multi-caste villages. So, in medieval period, the caste defined who could be peasant. It created hereditary manual laborers to sustain peasant agriculture, and it provided for the village artisan and servant to serve the material and social needs of the peasants. In the rural setup, superior caste enjoyed the privileged position. Higher caste peasants, on the basis of superiority of their caste, were assessed at concessional rates as compared to the rayat, that is ordinary peasants. The Pargana Jaipur clearly point out that the superior caste were assessed at much concessional rates, while an ordinary cultivator was taxed at rupees 2 per bigha. Mahajans and Brahman and new Assami paid at the rate of rupees 1.50 per bigha, while Chaudhuris and Rajputs were charged only rupees 1.25 per bigha. Even the resource base of the superior caste was distinctly larger than the rayas and the manual caste. The documents from Eastern Rajasthan clearly suggest that the land holdings held by the superior caste were much larger in amount as compared to rayas and manual caste. If we analyze caste-wise distribution pattern of Persian wheel owned by individual peasants in Pargana, Jalor in western Rajasthan, it confirmed that large amount of resource base was concentrated in the hands of the superior caste during the medieval period. The table given below. So,
sorry to interrupt. Please conclude it soon. Learners are leaving.
Higher castes such as Brahmins, Rajputs, Banyas, Charans, etc. generally did not work in the fields. They used to get their lands. They used to get their lands cultivated by wage laborers or through the system of beggar by the manual caste labor. The Rajput peasants of Haryana, they are saying that they cultivate badly, for his women are more or less strictly secluded and never work in the field. While consider it degrading to actually follow the plow and will always employ hired plowmen if he can possibly afford it. This caste was one of the main factor of rural differentiation. Sociologists and historians debate over the mobility aspect of caste. That is, caste is being the main hindrance in the mobility of profession in India. However, high degree of commercialization in the rural areas appear to be one of the major factor instrumental in social mobility and change. Referring to the Punjab region, Chetan Singh in 1991, he's saying, the enrockment of the market created possibilities of greater social mobility in a rural community where custom permitted only a marginal change in the social status. He's saying that Zamidari sale in Pargana, in which a non-Muslim carpenter sold his village to two non-Muslims, Mullah Daud referred to one Brahmin leading a caravan of bullocks from Puri in Odisha to Goa in eastern UP. The professional class of Mahajans was not necessarily the preserve of the Banyas. So, transformation of tribals from nomads and pastoralists were sedentary agriculturists, and their interaction with settled societies led to cultural transformation of this tribe. In this regard, mobility of the Jat is worth mentioning. The Jats, a pastoral tribe of 8th century, Sindh assumed the status of peasant or zamindar by 16th century. In spite of initial resistance, the tribals were brought into the field of traditional Hindu social structure. The tribals of Jharkhand or Chota Nagpur and also the Mongoloids got subsumed into the Kshatriya fold and called themselves as Rajgons.
Please conclude it.
The construction of fabricated genealogies to assume Kshatriya status clearly point out the upward movement of the tribals in the region. Popularization of legends emphasizing the association of Hindu gods like Shiv and Parvati and Pandavas and Hanuman helped greatly in the acculturization of tribals. So here Irfan Habib is saying that the process of mobility in the caste-based society was often accompanied by a process of Sanskritization. However, where Sanskritization failed, Irfan Habib arguing that monotheistic movement condemned the ideology of the caste system. So, almost all Bhakti saints hailed from lower caste. Then we see that the relationship between the artisans and the village menials or servants, the other member of the village community, form part of one of the most interestingly argued debates among the historians, anthropologists and sociologists. So Karl Marx here saying that in the existence of an unalterable division of labor, wherein the rural artisans and manuals serve the village as a whole in lieu of customary payment in kind or in the form of land assignment. Here Max Weber saying this caste-based labor as demiurgic labor, but W.H. Weiser in the Hindu Jajmani system argues that in the Jajmani tires, services were provided by the village servants to individual families. So ritualistic relationship between the upper caste families and the menials, but such relationship only exists in case of family priest. In contrast, it appears that the services rendered by the village artisans were provided for the entire village and not to individual families. Documents from Western Rajasthan even show that the services of priests to temples and that of
Sahin. Hello.
That of Charan were also for the entire village and not for individual families.
Hello.
If Charan of village Kaleti, Pargana Jalor surrendered his share once he decided not to render service to the village, then there appears hardly any change in the social status of the menial caste. Their subjugation by the superior caste peasants continued unabated.
Sign, please conclude
that the basic line of division between peasants and the landless were set socially by the caste system, which by compulsion prevented the menial caste from tilling the soil on their own. They served as reserve workforce. The Jajmani ties were the most crucial aspect of village artisan relationship with other members of the village community. The village artisans were of two types, independent and the ones tied with the entire village community. The latter rendered compulsory customary service, in which they received customary service from the agricultural produce. Rural artisans under Jajmani ties were paid from the common village fund for rendering service to the entire village. The village servants could be paid either in cash, that is, which we called Sulkhi in Western Rajasthan, Khalek in Sekhawati region, Kakpalla in Ambar, and Agwar in Banaras, or in kind could be in the form of law or Persian will, or in the form of land called. So, in addition, they received miscellaneous supplementary collection.
Oh, please conclude. Come to conclusion. Hello. Sahin, please conclude.
Let me see that peddlers and merchants were a common feature of the rural societies. Merchants were an important link in the disposal of agricultural produce for revenue payment. They were also important for certain other processes of revenue collection like cartage, sale of grain, etc. Since the state preferred to collect the revenue in cash, peasants were eager to sell off the grains immediately after the harvest to make revenue payment. Even when the revenue was collected in kind, the state was in hurry to dispose of grain. The need to sell agricultural products at the earliest made the role of rural merchants very significant in the whole operation. During our period, we hear for the first time the presence of specialized grain merchants. Here also emerged prominent during this period. There appears to be hierarchy among the grain dealers. They also acted as money lenders. Barani mentions that they become enormously rich by advancing loans to the Turkish noble. Banjaras were itinerant merchant class, but anyone involved in transporting grains and other goods in bulk was called as Banjaras. So what we see that medieval society was generally perceived as homogeneous, non-stratified and unchanging. However, recent researchers have shown that the medieval society was highly stratified. Though caste played an important role in determining social relations, social mobility was very much present. Since the land to man ratio was favorable, state's interest was to keep the peasant tied to the land. The period was also marked by large-scale peasantization of the tribals. Fakir, can we conclude here? Hello.
Yes, you can conclude and
Hello.
end the session. Hello.
End the session soon.
Hello.
Hello.
Learners are leaving. You conclude
Hello.
The session within a
minute. Hello, Dr. Shakir.
Hello.
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 Hello. Hello. Hello, Shakir, can we conclude here?
Yes, you can
or
conclude.
We continue?
No, you can conclude immediately.
Hello?
Sir, conclude immediately.
Hello?
Sir, message likh diyo.
She is not reading the message. I have written in chat box also. You tell her. Learners are leaving.
Sir.
Please, Devyota, I also called you. But your phone
sir,
is switched off. Dekhantu apan tike, dekhantu.
Sir.
Hello.
Madam, please conclude.
Hello.
Conclude kari diyo. Are sari diyo.
Like a nice subha, sir.
देवी तो कोई कहली देवी तो सुन लेनी
हेलो
हेलो साहिन
हेलो देवी तो आर यू लिसनिंग हेलो
यस मैम मैडम प्लीज कंक्लूड
तार कनेक्शन बोध हुए लागू नहीं है आम आवाज सब सुबुझी ताको सुबह जाओ नहीं
देवियो तो वो कौन तो नागो से सारी देवे
सर इस सोशन को बारंबार गलाने सारा बोली सीस ताको सुनी पाऊं
Hello.
Madam, please conclude the session.
Hello.
Madam,
your voice is not audible to me. I don't know what is the problem here.
Madam, please disconnect and
Hello.
Internet.
Hello, ma'am. Hello. Ma'am.
हेलो महाभारत समझ आउछ सबको
सर
तो हमें आकु बे सेशन को ओवर करबा कारण ऑलरेडी बहुत से कहिछंती
हां
जो अनलिमिटेड सोसाइटी रा तो मीडियाबल सोसाइटी जो सोशल इकोनॉमिक और कल्चरल एस्पेक्ट से कहिले वो डिटेल से कहिछंती हैला किंतु लर्नर्स मान कर बहुत कम अच्छे से आम को जितने जल्दी हो पाए आम आपको कंट्रोल कर
हेलो
हेलो
सर कौन
हाँ वी कैन ओवर द सेशन वी कैन एंड द
सेशन ओके वी कैन एंड द सेशन थैंक यू
So session is over. Any doubt from the learners? They can ask the questions. But where is the resource person? Hello.
Gotte thoi chanda mo koi le edo change kari.
Se tanahan ti chali.
Sir, sir.
Chali ho leni bode resource person.
Sir, sir.
Kaun kora jibo? Kaun to apun?
Sir, Sakir sir.
Sakir bhi nahan ti bode.
Sir, jadi kichhi learner ko question achi nala me kaun end kari session ta.
क्वेश्चन तो गोटे दिटा अच्छी किंतु से कुआडे गले
हेलो सर हेलो सर
यस यस
हां सर गुड इवनिंग मोर असाइनमेंट रे दिटा क्वेश्चन सर होनी तो असाइनमेंट सबमिट करियो रे 14 तारीख को तो सर से क्वेश्चन दिटा रो आंसर मते केमती मिलियो
आपनो प्लीज आपनो मेल आईटा लिखि दंतो सेतर सर रिप्लाई दे देबे आपन
ओके सर
अक्षर नहीं तो हो
और ये तो सेशन ओवर ही कर रहा था
सर सर
आ देखो वो से ज्ञान तांग संग मो कांटेक्ट करू छी करितले फोन करितले
सर
से ज्ञानेंद्र
सर
ज्ञानेंद्र
सर
ज्ञानेंद्र हम तो आपन जो कोई नथिले
सर सर
हम तो दे छी आ गुटे अपलोड हेनी कोर 5 टा
सर
गुटेटा अपलोड हेले से कोर 6 रो गुटे जेटा ब्लॉक अपलोड हे छी त हम कहि छी से काम आरंभ करसुंती
सर सर
ठीक टाइम रे तो दे देबे से बोधे नै
हाँ सर मो टॉर्चर अच्छा
हाँ अपन तो टॉर्चर अच्छा थी आओ अरे ठीक है जी सेशन सॉरी का देखता हूँ रेस्ट क्यों तो कि पास्ता वाजी गला पास्ता दोस्त
सर सर सर
ठीक है जी ओके
नमस्कार
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 नमस्कार